We can have everyone take their seats. We'll start the next session. Go ahead and get started because we're a few minutes behind schedule. So if everyone can take their seats and quiet down, we'll go ahead and start the session. This is session two on polychlorinated biphenyls, or PCBs. As you heard this morning, PCBs are what we call legacy contaminants. They were chemicals, I think Andy mentioned, that all things are somewhat useful. They were considered useful industrial chemicals, but found later on to be persistent bioaccumulative toxic chemicals, and that's why we care about them in San Francisco Bay. The RMP has been measuring PCBs in water, sediment, and biota, specifically fish tissue, which is the ultimate target for management efforts that you will hear about, for several decades now. Unfortunately, the data so far have shown that we're not making much progress towards a fishable, swimmable San Francisco Bay, and attaining that goal may take decades more, but scientists and managers are honing in on strategies to get us there. Our speakers will discuss what data have been collected, what those data are showing us, summarize ongoing and needed studies to guide management actions, and provide an update on those management actions, as well as the future steps needed to achieve that ultimate goal. So I'm your moderator for this session. I'm Bridgette DeShields. Tom mentioned me earlier today. I'm the chair of the Regional Monitoring Program's Technical Review Committee. I'm with Integral Consulting, and I've been a scientist working in San Francisco Bay for over 30 years. In fact, I was one of the initial RMP collaborators doing lab work initially before I joined the TRC several years ago. I won't say how long. I'll introduce each of our speakers, and they'll talk about this important topic. So the first one is Dr. Jay Davis. You can call him Dr. Jay. He told me he likes that, and he got a PhD because, you know, Dr. Jay in basketball, one of his idols. So he's a lead scientist for the RMP and co-director of San Francisco Estuary Institute's Clean Water Program. He specialized in studying PCBs in the Bay since he joined the staff of the RMP in 1995.
Thank you, Bridgette. It's great to be here for an in-person RMP annual meeting again, and not to have to worry about my internet giving out like it did last year, right before my talk. The goal of the RMP is to collect data and communicate information about water quality in San Francisco Bay. And in this talk, I'm gonna briefly describe how RMP PCB studies are informing management of PCBs. Oops, should show my slide. I want to start by talking about the pulse for a second and highlighting that historic photo project that we really got into and enjoyed doing, where we were able to find some historic photos from before the Clean Water Act and then pair them with current photos in the same locations. Another note about the pulse is that we didn't quite get it totally final. We were very close, maybe about a day short, but we are posting the final proof of the pulse on the website, on the RMP pulse webpage. Some of you have been looking for it and haven't found it yet, but Martin, is it now up? Okay, we now have it posted on the website, so you can see what the pulse looks like, but that's not the one that you should save in your collection. Wait for the final version that we'll announce in another couple days. So the Clean Water Act started us on a journey toward a bay that is fishable, swimmable, and safe for aquatic life. We've come a long way and made many great strides forward in the past 50 years. 50 years ago, the bay was a dumping ground and a stinking cesspool. This is all well documented in the pulse. Today, the bay generally looks cleaner and is much cleaner, and there have been many successes. These successes under the Clean Water Act are highlighted in the pulse by the many great perspectives that have been written by the authors that were mentioned earlier. But we're not there yet in meeting Clean Water Act goals. The bay is partially swimmable, partially fishable, and not totally safe for aquatic life. In addition to legacy challenges, we have new challenges related to climate change, population growth, and the use of new chemicals. PCB contamination, as was mentioned in the last session, is one of the remaining bits of unfinished business. The first step in effectively addressing a problem is to have a clear understanding of the problem. And for PCBs in the bay, this means understanding PCBs in bay fish. The PCB problem in the bay is primarily tracked by RMP fish monitoring. This graph shows the latest data set on PCBs in bay fish, the full data set from 2019. And the bars show average concentrations for each of the 16 species that we monitored. And then the dots show the individual data points for the different samples. And the lines on the graph, the yellow line is a threshold used by the Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessment to decide when they would recommend no consumption of a fish with PCBs. It's 120 parts per billion. And then the other line I want to focus your attention on is the blue line, which is the PCB TMDL target of 10 parts per billion. So you can see that many of the average concentrations are well above that blue line. I'm going to break this down even further. There's two parts really to the problem. At the top of the graph are a number of species that have higher concentrations, and these are species that live and spend their lives in the margin areas where their contamination is greater. These species have very high levels. The shiner surf perch, for example, are 20 times higher than the PCB TMDL target. Other species are also way above the target. But one of the bright spots, potential hopeful areas of the PCB problem is that PCB concentrations in these margin areas may be more controllable. And I'll talk more about that. Part B of the problem is regional contamination and species like striped bass, white croaker, sturgeon are further down on the graph. They have moderate levels of contamination. They're still above the TMDL target, but they're obtaining their PCBs by swimming throughout the bay. So this is a much harder problem to control. It's going to take longer to try to knock those levels down. And I want to focus in more on shiner surf perch. And one of the, this is the main indicator species for PCBs in the bay. And one of the great things about this species is that it is very localized. It has high site fidelity. And when we measure this species in different places along the bay margins, it is a great indicator of spatial differences. And so each of the points with the wide spread go from, they're clusters of 3 points for different locations, ranging from San Leandro Bay at the top to Berkeley Marina at the bottom, which I'm not showing. But in this talk, I'm going to focus on two areas of particular interest, San Leandro Bay and Redwood Creek and Steinberger Slough. So another key point, obviously the levels are way above the targets and they're not showing signs of decline. So this map shows these two areas in their locations and their watersheds. We selected these areas for many reasons. One is the high levels of contamination. Another big one is that we're anticipating significant management actions in these watersheds. A lot of efforts going in to try to reduce PCB concentrations in stormwater. And so the big question is, there are a lot of PCBs already out in the bay. If these actions are taken, can we see a response in fish in the bay? Can we knock those those concentrations down at all. And these are the best places to look. So zooming in on San Leandro Bay, this is kind of typical of local watersheds where there's an undeveloped upper watershed area, a residential area below that, and then down close to the bay, there is a zone of industrial and old industrial land use. And these are the areas that have the worst PCB contamination due to a couple of main factors. There are contaminated sites in these areas. Then also these areas have infrastructure that have PCBs that were in the paint, the caulk, the building materials in these areas. I'm gonna go through a couple of contaminated site examples in San Leandro Bay, and particularly spending a little time talking about the General Electric site. This is one of the most contaminated sites in the region with a long history of management, but kind of typical of the worst sites. This was a facility where they produced and maintained, repaired transformers, electrical equipment for decades. And as was unfortunately very common back in those days, there were a lot of accidental spills, there were leaks, and there was negligent disposal. On this site, they tried to bury some of the PCB oils, leading to highly contaminated soil, subsurface oil plume of PCB oil, really severe contamination of the soil. The concentrations of PCBs in soils from sites like this are a million times higher than the concentrations that we see in bay sediment. So these sites are like basically mountains of PCBs that can potentially be mobilized and go downstream to the bay. There has been cleanup at this site, and it began in 2012 and 2013. They did a lot. They excavated soil, they did capping, they extracted groundwater and treated it, and the GE was responsible for ongoing monitoring. But as part of our efforts, our studies to understand PCBs in this margin area, and knowing that the management of the site had not been totally completed when we started doing some stormwater sampling in 2017, we decided to sample downstream of the GE property. And we found in stormwater, in the particles in stormwater coming from this area, in this first area called line H, we saw super high concentrations on particles. 2,600 nanograms per gram. This is one of the highest stormwater particle concentrations that we've seen in the Bay Area. We went back again in 2020 and basically got another super high value. So this is after all these actions were taken to try to remedy the PCB contamination at this location. On the other side, also downstream of GE, we sampled this other area called Line I, another one of the stormwater lines. And the concentrations there were also high, not as high as on the other side, but still quite elevated. So how high are these levels? This is a graph that shows the stormwater particle concentrations from 90 watersheds throughout the Bay. This is more work that's been done under the RMP. Line H is the third highest. Line I is also at the upper end of the distribution. And this graph is basically like a sideways fruit tree showing the low-hanging fruit for PCB management. So that line H value is very low-hanging. Another site of interest in this watershed with high contamination is the Union Pacific Railroad site. Also about a million times higher concentrations in some of the soil than in the bay. And at this site, this has been something that we've been talking about in the RMP PCB work group for many years, and getting baseline monitoring in place in anticipation of action, but the action has been held up for legal and regulatory reasons for several years. So given that context, what do we see in the Bay data downstream? At the upper end of the graph, these are sediment PCB concentrations. Below the GE property in the channel that's draining that area, very high concentrations of PCBs. In the Bay, the concentrations, the normal range is between 1 and 10 parts per billion. So here they're 70, 80, 90 times higher downstream of GE. So this is consistent with those high concentrations in the stormwater particles. That's not a surprise. What's surprising there is that there's so much coming off of that property after the remediation. Downstream of the Union Pacific Railroad site, the concentrations were not super high. They're still elevated above what we see in the Bay, but not super high. And I haven't been able to sort of confirm this. Mark Johnson from the Water Board, who was working on these sites, recently retired, said something about that channel being dredged in some time recently. So that may be it may be due to that, in which case that's a sign of a management action that actually had a positive effect. Otherwise, it's just kind of puzzling why the concentrations below that property are not higher. And then there's another channel with kind of intermediate concentrations, Elmer's Creek at the bottom of San Leandro Bay. So there were a couple of surprises here. We're kind of surprised at every turn when we try to line up the Bay data with information on contaminated sites. So our straightforward expectations may be wrong, they often are. And cleanup actions may not work as expected. It's actually kind of a consistent theme with PCB and DDT cleanups that an action is taken, dredging or contaminant removal, but it's hard to get all of the residues. Another study that we did was a simple mass budget model for San Leandro Bay. And this is where there's some hopeful signs that this is a very simple model, and San Leandro Bay is different from other priority margin areas. But it suggests that if there were no inputs, if we were able to reduce the load significantly, that in a relatively short period of time, like within about 10 years, we would see a big change in the concentrations in sediment. And then it's pretty safe assumption that based on data again, that the fish would follow the sediment pretty quickly. So this suggests for one that the inputs in this area are continuing, but that if we could reduce the watershed inputs, that we would see a response. We would see the fish concentrations in San Leandro Bay decline. But again, this is a very simple model. There's a lot of uncertainty because the model is so simplistic, and in addition to other reasons. So quickly, I want to talk about the other area and the other priority margin area, Redwood Creek. And this area has the two highest bars here, indicating the lowest hanging fruit in terms of stormwater particles. And there are a couple of properties there that have been undergoing study and remediation. The remediation has been happening fairly recently, and it's not completed yet. But this area also includes a long-term fish monitoring station showing those levels that aren't changing. These properties have been well studied, and a lot of attention has been given to them, but the cleanups are still underway. We're also doing more RMP field studies. And we're doing a great collaboration with Stanford to understand the distribution of PCBs here and finding more surprising results that I don't have time to go into today. So what are the science needs for trying to make a dent in the PCB problem? We need adequate monitoring to support this data-driven approach. We need more robust fate modeling. We need to move beyond the simple one box model that we did for San Leandro Bay. And we're in the process of developing and funding a more rigorous and sophisticated model for the Bay and for these areas under the guidance of the PCB work group. So my take home message is, this is an area where we're not there yet. We haven't made much progress on PCBs, and there's a long way to go. The margin areas have the worst contamination, but the greatest potential for improvement. There does appear to be low-hanging fruit present, that there's sort of actions underway to address them. We need to expect the unexpected in the field, so we need to be out there monitoring. It needs to be a data-driven approach to management. And we're going to need both monitoring and modeling. So I'm just going to quickly show my colleagues who have contributed on this work and the RMP PCB work group. We're posting our presentations online, so you can refer to these links for more information. So how are we on time?
Is there a band called Monkey Face Pickle?
Prickleback? There should be. That was one of the information gaps that we filled with this last round of RMP fish monitoring.
So Jay, thanks for that. It's very interesting. I worked for a number of years with the University of Wisconsin on remediating sediments in different places. The conventional wisdom for many years was remove mass, eventually concentrations will go down. And we've got the cleanup in Richmond, and we've got Box River, and we've got various things that seems to suggest that that conventional wisdom may not be completely correct. That and for a system like the San Leandro Bay, what's happening at the sediment surface in the water may actually be really important mechanically to what's going on, and might suggest certain things like capping in place, even with thin layers, might be more important than what you're doing overall, as long as you've shut off the tap. What do you gather out of this in the confounding information? I mean, what's your kind of single most important, what I've learned over the last 10 years trying to chase this stuff down? What's your best observation as to what you've learned?
Well, a couple things. I'm kind of new to this, looking upstream at contaminated sites and things, but I still think that removing the mass is important, because if you cap downstream, but I think what seems to be a recurring problem is that you can clean up a site, but the downstream conveyances are still contaminated. So there's kind of this plume of, you know, contaminated sediment that remains and continues to, you know, go into the bay. And if you don't get that out, if you put a cap in downstream of that, then you're just going to get more contamination. In the bigger picture, the ultimate answer to trying to, you know, normally what happens in an estuary like the bay that traps sediment is that sediment, you know, the sediment accumulates and you have burial. And the problem is that the sediment that's washing in from the watershed is still contaminated. But if we could get a flow of clean sediment from the watershed, that would be the ultimate long-term solution that will bury the PCBs in these places. So, but that's, you know, that would help the bay in many ways. But that's not an easy thing to do.
Hold other questions. We've got another speaker, and we're going to have a panel after, so there'll be lots more opportunities to ask Jay questions. So I'm going to call up our next speaker. Okay. Setenay Bozkurt. Frucht. Did I say your name right? Thank you. She is a senior engineer leading the TMDL and climate change section at the Water Board. She's been at the Water Board for 10 years working on sediment TMDLs, flood control project permitting, and on TMDL implementation for PCBs for the last 2 years. She participates in various RMP work groups, looking at sediment and PCB issues and management questions. She was an engineering geomorphologist at ESA working on fluvial restoration projects before joining the Water Board. So.
Jay's extra slides.
Oh. Okay, sorry. I went the other way and it was still.
I had some extra.
Oh, you had extra slides. Okay.
You want me to go over those, Dr. J?
Okay, one more, maybe. There we go.
Okay. Well, good morning, everyone. I am Setenay Bozkurt Frucht. I lead the TMDLs and climate change section at the Water Board. I'm delighted to be here this morning to talk about San Francisco Bay's PCB impairment and the actions that the Water Board has been taking or compelling others to take to reduce PCB loads to the Bay and to appropriately remediate PCB contamination. My talk will consist of three main points. I will start by summarizing San Francisco Bay's PCB problem. I will then talk about what the Water Board has been doing about it, and then I will conclude with our actions in development and future plans. So PCBs are oils to which chlorine has been added to keep them from breaking down in industrial applications. Because PCBs are stable at high temperatures, they had numerous industrial uses beginning in the 20s, and they were widely used in military and industrial operations around the Bay. They were also extensively used in building materials, such as paints and caulking, and road infrastructure, such as expansion joints. The route of human exposure for PCBs is primarily through fish consumption, and they tend to accumulate in fat, so we find the highest levels in fatty fish like shiner surf perch. High levels of PCBs in San Francisco Bay fish prompted a health advisory, which then triggered the PCB total maximum daily load, TMDL for short, per Clean Water Act. A TMDL is a water quality restoration plan for reducing pollutants and achieving water quality objectives. The target fish tissue concentration is set at 10 parts per billion, PPB, and the TMDL is set at 10 kilograms per year from external sources. And these targets are protective of both human and wildlife. So the TMDL estimated external and internal sources of PCBs delivered to the Bay. The external sources are shown in blue text and the internal sources in yellow. The size of each arrow indicates the relative magnitude of the load, and the color of each arrow indicates how concentrated the input stream is. Darker colors are more concentrated. External sources were estimated to contribute about 34 kilograms of PCBs per year. And these sources include urban stormwater being the largest source, delta inflow, municipal wastewater, and industrial wastewater. Internal sources are the movement or release of PCBs from bottom sediments. These are 1 to 2 orders of magnitude larger, up to hundreds or thousands of kilograms. So there's a large mass of PCBs in the Bay, which is significantly higher than the annual mass loading. Continual mixing of bottom sediments from wave action and mixing by organisms provide an ongoing supply of PCBs to the water and biota. This figure illustrates estimated loads in dark brown to allocated loads in orange or light brown, which add up to 10 kilograms per year. Of the estimated PCB inputs, as I said, stormwater is the largest source, delivering 20 kilograms per year of PCBs. The TMDL calls for stormwater PCB loads to be reduced by about 90%, from 20 to 2 kilograms per year over 20 years. I can illustrate this with a simple cartoon on the right. The total amount of urban runoff loads is equivalent to the weight of a 5-gallon water bottle used in office water coolers. And 2 kilograms per year can be represented with a 2-liter bottle of soda, which weighs exactly 2 kilograms. An 18 kilogram reduction is challenging, especially because PCBs are broadly dispersed across the urban landscape at low concentrations. We are finding at most grams of PCBs in stormwater in any single location. Loads from Central Valley are the second largest source at 11 kilogram. But we should note that the PCB concentrations in sediment delivered from Central Valley are low in the picograms per liter range. However, the flow is very large, resulting in a significant PCB load from the Central Valley. We did not designate any implementation action for PCBs coming from the Delta. The TMDL calls for a reduction of about 40% to 5 kilograms per year, and we expect that this reduction will occur due to natural attenuation. Municipal and industrial wastewater plants do a good job of removing PCBs, so I won't cover this source further today. This graphic illustrates the magnitude of PCBs in sediments. The bigger the dot, the higher the PCB concentration. The on-land samples represent sediment collected in street gutters and rights of way. The in-bay sample concentrations are shown using a continuous color scheme shown on the bar in the upper right-hand corner. PCB concentrations range from low in blue to high in red, with yellow denoting an intermediate concentration. North Bay is mostly blue. As you can see, that means clean. Central Bay has the highest PCB concentrations, especially around the margins. To give you an idea of actual PCB concentration at hotspots, they can range as high as 1.2 million parts per billion at Mare Island and 82,000 parts per billion at Yosemite Slough. The light gray shading around the bay represents urban areas. This is also where old urban areas in the mid 50s, I should say. This is also where old industrial areas are located and where PCBs were used a lot. You can see from the large red dots along the shoreline in Richmond, Oakland, and San Francisco waterfronts, they have this, some of the highest upland and shoreline PCB concentrations. There's an environmental justice dimension to this story as well. These old industrial areas are often near where disadvantaged communities live, because historically these were the only areas where they were allowed to purchase homes, and in present times, because the less contaminated upland areas are simply not affordable. Additionally, PCBs from these older industrial areas are transported to the bay and cause some popular fish species caught from nearby fishing locations to have high contaminant concentrations, making them unsafe to eat. Another concern related to PCBs in bay sediment is the erosion of buried bay sediment, which poses a significant problem with respect to recovery of the bay from PCB contamination. This pathway may become larger as climate change and sea level rise impacts are more prominent and as sediment input to the bay decreases. So what is the Water Board doing about this? And how are we implementing the TMDL, our Water Quality Restoration Plan? We are implementing our plan primarily through permits. Urban stormwater, which is the largest input to the bay, is managed through the Municipal Regional Stormwater Permit, the MRP for short, that was readopted in June for the third time. In addition, industry and military are cleaning up hotspot sites. Dredgers are testing bay sediments and properly disposing of materials with high levels of PCBs. And the RMP continues to sample bay water, sediment, and fish. Our approach to understand and tackle the PCB problem and to implement our restoration plan has been science-based, phased and evolutionary, and collaborative. We have been working closely with our scientific agency and consultant partners to collect data, develop and test models, develop solutions, and adapt as we learn more. And we have incorporated considerations of impacts of climate change, as well as environmental justice and racial equity issues into all of our work, planning and permitting. As I said, the stormwater is managed in most of the urbanized Bay Area through the MRP, which applies to a total of 79 cities, counties, and flood control districts outlined in yellow. The permit requires reducing pollutants to the maximum extent practicable, which is a standard we have implemented through a phased approach. It's an iterative, progressive approach, continuously evaluating what is possible at what cost. When we started implementing the TMDL requirements in the first MERP in 2009, we had limited information about sources and how to control them. And we had essentially no implementation experience we could draw upon from here or anywhere else, really. In the first MERP, we required pilot testing of a variety of implementation measures. Based on this implementation experience and data collection, we reassessed which control measures should be implemented. In the second MERP, we focused attention on the most promising control measures, and the permit required specific load reductions. And in MERP 3, we challenged municipalities to do more faster and at a programmatic level. So we turned implementation up, building up on successes of previous phases. And major actions for stormwater, urban stormwater management include attending to old industrial areas, as Dr. J also mentioned. MERP permittees find areas of PCB contamination and stop that contamination from entering the bay to turn off the PCB tap, so to speak. It includes identifying source properties. As PCBs were used in many industrial applications, there are still properties contaminated with relatively high concentration of PCBs. Accordingly, finding source properties is an ongoing and important component of the proposed PCBs control program adopted in MERP. If I wanted to give you a sense of the amount of PCBs we're talking about, I would estimate that we have achieved 3 to 4 kilograms of year of PCB load reduction since going back to the first stormwater permit. These load reductions may seem small, but even small amounts of PCBs in fish are a danger to public health. Think about it this way: a single grams of PCBs can contaminate about 10,000 kilograms of fish to a level unsafe to eat in any amount. A single gram. So even modest load reductions can be meaningful, particularly if it reduces loading to areas where people are fishing. In addition to source properties, we know that PCBs can be present at high concentrations in building materials and in bridge and roadway expansion joint caulks, as shown in the picture on the left. Through monitoring and control measure design studies, we learned that some of older buildings contained a lot of PCBs in the caulk. We have estimates that more than 10,000 kilograms of PCBs may be residing in the caulk in older buildings. Most recently, we have come to learn that a building in South Bay has a caulk in it with PCB concentrations of 64,000 ppm. Remember that the load allocation is just 2 kilograms per year. So it is critical that when these buildings are demolished, the PCBs are not released for transport to receiving waters. Green stormwater infrastructure, like bioretention cells, is generally effective at removing PCBs in runoff. So in addition to source control, it's a key tool to control those PCBs that remain in the urban environment. Continuing with the tap water analogy, we know that the dirtiest tap water comes from on-land PCB cleanup sites. Even though the TMDL didn't assign specific actions, it calls for implementing on-land source control measures and states an expectation that these sources will decline over time as cleanups are completed. To date, Water Board completed cleanup of 19 upland sites and 8 in-bay sites. We are overseeing 25 active cleanup sites, which are in the process of investigation or remediation. Please note that PCB cleanups are complex. They involve numerous sources, including soil, sediment, building materials, and contamination transported via stormwater, and take time to complete. Information on the volume of PCB contaminated soil is not readily available for projects. However, to provide some context, we know that approximately 50,000 metric tons of PCB contaminated soils were removed from about 9 cleanup sites where we have some information. Maximum concentrations at those sites range between 2 to 2,000 ppm. In one site, we can roughly estimate several kilograms to tens of kilograms of PCBs were removed. So when we look back to evaluate the recovery of the whole bay from PCBs, we can say that the scale of load reductions hasn't been substantial enough and speed of recovery has been slow. However, the picture looks more optimistic if we look at margin areas. We know that we will be able to move the needle on PCB recovery by focusing on reducing loads in priority areas, such as Emeryville Crescent, San Leandro Bay, and Steinberger Slough. Jay explained this graph on the right. It's basically, you know, it shows that the small areas, these priority margin areas, will be responsive to load reductions. And reducing watershed inputs to the system would greatly accelerate recovery. So for a future revision of the TMDL, for example, we may not consider the whole bay, but we may focus on margin areas with elevated PCBs. Alternatively, we may focus on highly impacted segments of the bay, such as the central bay, which will more readily respond to PCB reductions. SFEI is currently working on developing a regional watershed dynamic model. The image on the right here shows the subregions of the bay as model. This model will provide updated estimates of PCB loads from watersheds calibrated by ongoing monitoring efforts by the RMP and other stakeholders, and will help us evaluate trends. We will also continue our close collaboration with municipalities as we depend on them to make PCB reductions happen. We will focus on upland and in-bay site cleanups, as the amount of PCBs removed from the soil in individual sites can be quite substantial. We may consider revising the waste load allocations in the TMDL or revising schedule of implementation on condition that diligent efforts to implement controls in a timely manner are being made. We're pursuing all avenues to help San Francisco Bay recover. We're pushing municipalities, working with EPA and Department of Toxic Substances Control to compel cleanups. And we are doing all of this while incorporating into our thinking and modeling the impacts of climate change on sea level rise, groundwater, watershed flows, and with a racial equity and environmental justice lens. Thank you.
So I'm struck by the mass that is potentially available in one building's caulk compared to the mass that we are trying to get to as a target for the estuary. And it leads me to be particularly concerned about some of these sites on land where if we blow it, we slide all the way back down, or maybe slide back up the graph that you have there. So are we able to have some sense of that, like how many of those sites are out there that could really set us back years if we don't control them adequately?
We do have a sense of what those sites are. I mean, that building material information comes from a study done by SFEI and other scientists in 2014, where they estimated the potential input. So we have some knowledge, and the answer is yes, but I don't know, how that we know all of the sites that have these potential issues. So we are still gathering information, and we're really trying to focus on those sites we know where, blowing up of one site could result in a catastrophic input of PCBs to the bay. I don't know, Tom, do you want to add something?
I could, but I'll wait till
the... Okay.
Thank you. Andy, I'm Chris Summers. Sorry, I got to keep my mouth. Okay. I'm Chris Summers, and I represent the stormwater programs on the TRC for the RMP. And I think you know this, Andy, I hope you know this. There are
requirements now in the municipal regional permit for municipalities, and there have been for about 5 years now, for municipalities to enact ordinances that require buildings that are demolished that fit a certain characteristic, that they were constructed during this period of time where PCBs were used. And so that data collection on how many buildings there are out there, there's sampling required now of the building material, is still kind of in process of collection. We've got about, I think about 3 years of data collection now. So it's still a work in progress. And I think as we get a data set over the course of the next few years, we'll have a better answer to your question. But I think the good part about this discussion and this issue is there are ordinances in place. Obviously they can, the protocols and the processes and the oversight can always evolve and improve over time. But one of the requirements in the MRP is for the demolition process to take a more active look from the project proponents themselves of the PCB concentrations and the mass that are in those, and handle that material consistent with EPA regulations for disposal. So that's a key, you know, step towards addressing that type of PCB contribution.
Move on to the next speaker. We'll have, like I said, more opportunities for questions. So our next speaker is Karen Irwin. She's with the US EPA. She's a specialist with the Pacific Southwest office. In the Land, Chemicals, and Redevelopment Division, she manages PCB cleanup sites in San Francisco Bay, as well as the Los Angeles area, and leads climate resiliency efforts for her branch. Prior to this, Karen formed collaborative partnerships with local governments to advance sustainability projects, including green infrastructure. In other divisions at EPA, she acted on TMDL loads, or total maximum daily loads, for water quality and regional particulate matter plans for air quality to meet national standards. Karen?
Thank you, Bridgette, for the introduction, and I'm happy to be here today to talk about EPA's PCB cleanup activities in the Bay Area. So EPA's cleanup authority for PCBs comes from the Toxic Substances Control Act, adopted in 1976. And within EPA, TSCA is implemented by our Land, Chemicals, and Redevelopment Division, of which I am part of. We also have a Superfund division that independently oversees sites on the national priority list, some of which are also contaminated with PCBs, such as Hunter's Point or Yosemite Slough. And TSCA is directly implemented by EPA regional offices. We have 10 regional offices around the country. And this is very different than RCRA, the Resource Conservation and Recovery Act, which delegates oversight authority to states. Also, California has its own authorities, as you know, to regulate PCBs. So we coordinate closely with DTSC and the regional water boards on many of our PCB cleanup sites. So the most common type of PCB cleanup is a risk-based disposal cleanup. And we work upfront with the responsible parties to make sure that the site is adequately characterized for PCBs before they submit an application to us for approval. Both human health risk and eco risk are to be addressed. And EPA must make a finding of no unreasonable risk. And we commonly include a set of conditions in our approvals that modify the application we've received and are enforceable under TSCA. We also have a tool published on our website called PCB Fast, and I've included a link here to it in case you're interested in learning all about PCB cleanups under TSCA. So this map shows sites in the Bay Area that are managed by my division, excluding underground storage tanks. And all the dots you see here are PCB cleanup sites. So we have a lot in the Bay. The red squares are the RCRA permitted facilities. And we have a lot of sites that are located in quite close proximity to the shorelines. And as you know, sites that are in low-lying areas are at risk for rising sea levels and, you know, larger storm surges, as well as a rising groundwater table. So historical uses of PCBs mostly occurred between the 1950s and 1970s. And many of our PCB cleanup sites were former industrial sites that had transformers or capacitors on site that contained PCB oils, or they had hydraulic presses or heat transfer systems. And as you've heard, PCBs are also commonly found in commercial buildings and schools that were built between the 50s and 70s or renovated. And they've been found in old caulk, and but other things too, like paints and varnishes, insulation, adhesives, just a slew of building materials. Manufactured products that contain PCBs that are at levels equal to or greater than 50 milligrams per kilogram are not authorized for use under TSCA, and they must be removed for disposal. So several of our sites are former shipyards. Starting in the 1940s, it was common for PCBs to be added to marine paint, and boat repair typically included repainting. So I have a site I'm managing at the Port of LA where they stored sandblasted paint chips in open top bags that were subject to wind dispersal. Old crushing and auto repair sites that, you know, they crushed cars had sources of PCBs, maybe hydraulic fluid, recycled oil, brake fluid. There's a site in Redwood City that's currently under an EPA enforcement action where our inspector went out, found PCBs in the sediment. They had had an elevated conveyor belt that was shredding auto parts, metal auto parts, right above the water. And of course, PCBs got in sediment below. At some sites, the suspected source of PCBs is contaminated fill. Luckily now DTSC makes clean fill advisory guidelines for folks to use. But we've also found some sites where PCBs have been inadvertently spread into the soil by grading. Old drinking water tanks still in service can contain PCBs. The photo you see there on the left is San Jose Water Treatment Plant, and they found PCBs in epoxy that was used to fill holes in the bottom of the tank. And the photo next to it is Princeville, Hawaii. So the tank there had coal tar sealant on its interior containing PCBs. And it actually escaped in pretty low levels in the drinking water system because they were using vegetable oil as a lubricant to replenish water to the tank as they were pumping water into the tank. So both of these tanks have been remediated under my office. There's also illegal activities at some sites. You see historic dumping, maybe from adjacent sites that had PCBs. They suspect it as a source. They don't know what the source is. There are also cases of copper wires on transformers that are being vandalized, and that leading to PCB oil spills. So TSCA defines a cleanup site as the aerial extent of contamination. And fortunately for us, this broad definition enables us to not to basically extend our regulatory oversight to just beyond the immediate spill area, but to other areas of the site that may have PCBs, as well as adjacent offsite areas where the contamination may have spread. And we often find heterogeneous patterns of PCB impacted soils at sites. So we feel it's very important for the sampling done to fully delineate, you know, where the PCBs are, the full range of PCB concentrations, and where they may have migrated. And I've listed here some of the PCB mobilization pathways that can have implications for water bodies. So about 5 or 6 years ago, my group started regularly asking our responsible parties to test sediment in the storm drain inlets and outlets at their sites. And the interesting thing is they almost always find it at levels that are unacceptable as a risk to aquatic life. And sometimes sites also have direct overland flow into a water body. This is the case at a former shipyard that I manage at the Port of LA, where historically all of the runoff just flowed right directly into the adjacent harbor. And they found PCBs in the harbor sediment with the highest concentrations being closest to the shoreline. Also in streams that are tidally influenced, we might find that the PCBs and sediment can be spread upstream of the source from the tides or just dispersed further out from the source. So we have a number of PCB cleanup sites in the Bay Area where our authority under TSCA and Water Board is overlapping. And so we thought it would make sense to set up monthly calls so our respective project managers can talk about the sites. And we've also been coordinating with SFEI on some of our sites, including GE Oakland, which you heard about earlier. I have a couple slides on that. And we've looked at some of the data collected in their county urban runoff pollution prevention programs. So GE Oakland As you heard, it's been around for a while. We've actually overseen multiple remedial actions at the site for soil and groundwater, and it's currently undergoing redevelopment. So the storm drain outlet at the site had been tested for PCBs, but what's interesting is that when SFEI shared the data with us for the creek that Jay showed you to the north of the site, this led us to ask GE whether the site had historically drained into the street that drains into that creek. And GE said yes. In the 1990s, there had been an unpaved portion of the site that did drain into that street. So this table lays out when we received that data from SFEI and letters sent by both EPA and the Water Board to GE to conduct additional sediment sampling. And this is scheduled to take place in the upcoming rainy season. So I think it's a good example illustrating how coordination between the three parties is leading to more investigation and potentially more sediment cleanup by GE. These two sites, Jay went over Delta Star and the one a little bit south of it, 1411 Industrial Road. That's closer to the bay, maybe only 500 feet from the bay. From the Delta Star site, the storm drains discharge into Belmont Creek and Belmont Slough. And in 2018, PCBs were found in both storm drain sediment on site as well as off site at city owned storm drains. And so they're on track to be cleaned out later this year or in 2023. And this site, the 1411 Industrial Road, the PCBs in the storm drains were found to range a little over 1 milligram per kilogram to all the way up to more than 400 milligram per kilogram. And this map here shows the SFEI map for the Pulgas Pump Station South Watershed. And the Water Board sent a letter naming additional responsible parties. So we anticipate remediation of those drains to begin later this year or next year. So Leo Avenue in San Jose is in a heavily industrialized area. And storm drain sediment testing done years ago by the Santa Clara Valley Urban Runoff Pollution Prevention Program had identified PCBs in the drains even after they'd been cleaned out by the city. And questions remained about whether PCBs are still entering these drains from the source properties along the street. So this past February, EPA purchased six sediment filters that look like reverse witch's hats. And we worked with the city and the Water Board to install them. And after a few months, the Water Board collected and tested the sediment. And even though they did not detect PCBs, this really led us to realize, coordination, working together, we can collect and analyze PCBs and sediment that are entering public storm drains. And we could do this in other places. India Basin is a really good example of how EPA coordinated with the Water Board to address PCBs and sediment. This site had hosted a former shipyard that has now been converted to greenfield space. And this was with the help of EPA Brownfields grants and technical assistance. So back in 2013, EPA's Brownfields office had asked the city to test the sediment offshore that was in the city-owned property for PCBs. And when they were found, the Water Board took that data and said, well, let's expand that. Let's get more sampling out into the bay. And EPA's TSCA group gave oversight to the sampling and cleanup plan, which involved removal of the contaminated soil and sediment. There are two offshore sediment areas shown on this graph with yellow highlight, and these were covered with a sand cap as an alternative. They had lower PCB levels there, so that was an option. While it's less common, we do have sites where PCBs have been found in groundwater, most often where solvents are also present. And we have utilized the Water Board's environmental screening level of 330 milligrams per kilogram for PCBs in soil leaching to groundwater as a benchmark. And basically across the sites that we manage where we have PCBs in soil and we have shallow groundwater table, we want to consider potential pathways for PCBs to move into the groundwater and any hydrologically connected surface waters. So an interesting case is Owens Brockway. This site is in Oakland. It was a historic glass factory. And at one point, a glass furnace exploded. It sparked a fire in the basement, and there were PCB transformers in the basement. Lo and behold, it caused a major transformer PCB oil spill. PCBs were found in soil under the basement up to 12,000 milligrams per kilogram. And the groundwater table here is somewhat shallow. We did test the groundwater PCBs, and very, very low concentrations were found. However, we are concerned because there's a lot of PCBs in the soil there. And that could migrate eventually into the groundwater and it mixes with the bay. So we are at this site using the Water Board's ESL of 330 milligrams per kilogram as a soil cleanup goal. I wanted to mention that EPA Region 9 has a climate adaptation plan. And in June of this year, our associate director signed a policy memo that basically directs myself and other staff in our group to implement climate change resiliency into remedy protectiveness. So essentially, this involves evaluating any increased risk to human or ecological health from altered future conditions that may affect the site and the proposed remedy. And if needed, in our approvals, to require appropriate resiliency measures so that we can make a finding of no unreasonable risk. So in summary, EPA can utilize the data collected as part of a TMDL program or an urban runoff monitoring program to inform our regulatory oversight under TSCA. And I encourage sharing of sediment data, especially if it's found to be over 1 milligram per kilogram of PCBs. Soil samples collected on potential source properties are especially useful to us. And as we've seen, this data sharing can drive additional investigation and oversight activities by the involved agencies. Thank you.
And just call all the speakers up in front, and then you can, if you have a question for Karen, we can start out with that. All right, any questions for Karen specifically? Tom? No? Anybody?
I have a major thank you to Karen specifically for working with us. Yeah, the partnership between EPA and the Water Board, as you can see, is great.
Okay, just got to punch it harder. Hi, I'm Ellen Jock, Environmental and Cultural Resources Consultant. My alias is the mud lady in the bay. I move a lot of mud for the ports to beneficial use, ideally. But that's another part of the question. But I do have a question for Karen. You know, on the remediation, I mean, I'm going thinking back to the Toxic Hotspot Cleanup Act from many years ago, and that's state legislation that wasn't an EPA, but it's related. And there was a whole strategy coming out of that to clean up toxic hotspots. And I just thinking, well, gee, what's happened with the actual cleanup? I mean, what have we, have you got a good strategy for that? And what is the remediation choice of most efficient and effective?
I think removal is often removal, the bandwidth, you know. Yeah. Removal, or I think the interesting thing too is when it's fairly low levels, like I think the sand cap example I gave, they had maybe 3 milligram per kilogram. So that really wasn't too high. There are some technologies, I think they're a little bit more expensive, but some that actually are capable of drawing PCBs out of sediment. But we have yet to see those really adopted. I would say removal is is probably gonna be for appropriate disposal is probably going to be the thing that's the most protective.
And then removal to where?
To an appropriate disposal facility. So if it's above certain levels, it's got to go to something that's basically going to treat it as TSCA permitted waste or hazardous waste. But if it's less than that, it actually can go to a municipal landfill. But it depends on if the landfills will take it, and not all of them do.
I think Ellen was referring to technologies like Dick Luthi has done with carbon sequestration of PCBs and sediment. I know that's proposed for Hunter's Point, so I think that maybe leads to some of your question, Ellen, but it hasn't been implemented yet. And there's been pilot studies, but it hasn't really been fully tested in the field, in the Bay. It has been in other places. Question up here.
Hey, I wanted to, it's Khalil Abusaba. I work for the consulting firm WSP. Wanted to briefly touch on a question Dr. Gunther asked, if you're out there, Andy. Andy, heads up. He asked about, you know, the connection between the mass of PCBs and building structures and, you know, environmental benefit to abating those. Andy, if you are ever listening to these presentations in the water board with your water board member hat on, you're going to find the connections between the buildings and the loads really frustrating. You can't, it's just the math doesn't, there's not a real sensible way to figure it out without a lot of assumptions that just leave you guessing. It's easier to think about the benefit if you think about concentrations and practical experience. Remember the Eddy Street pumping station? I know they're your data. So it's 20 parts per million PCBs and sediments at that pumping station in the year 2000. I think you know this, but just to put on the record for everyone, after they cleaned out that pumping station, we never saw concentrations that high again. It was a one-time event. Something happened prior to 2000 that caused that and did not recur. You have to ask, was that a Loma Prieta singularity? When the Cypress freeway structure came down in 1989 in the Loma Prieta earthquake, did it have PCBs in that structure? Undoubtedly. We know that PCBs in the sealant material of road decks is a known source, and it had light ballast, and none of that was removed ahead of time. It was a disaster. Were there PCBs in the concrete that was being reworked and ground as they were hauling away and cleaning up after the disaster? Undoubtedly. Could that explain 20 parts per million PCBs in sediments in West Oakland? At this point, I'm at more likely than not. And the benefit of us really paying attention to buildings when we demolish them is we will actually abate the likelihood that you see single digit and double digit part per million PCBs in sediments. That's the known and quantifiable benefit that we can look at and point to. Good luck ever translating that back to mass. I don't know if you'll ever get there from here. I've given up. So. But if you think about practical experience, you can actually start to put together pretty good stories. So,
at this point, I think we'll take questions for any of the speakers. I see Jim here.
I wanted to, I'm not very certain about it, but I wanted to find out. A lot of the storm drain water that you get from these environments, they go directly into the bay, is it? It's not contained. So is how expensive or how possible is it to create storm drains that do not go directly into the bay, but you are collecting that water and processing it? Because we have been, there are lots of buildings constructed, there are industrial areas, and lots of them will have contaminants that will, with rainwater, go down into the bay. So one way of trying to demolish or identify all of these places, that's an eventual goal. But in the meantime, if one collects the storm water and then detect for things in them before they go into the bay, that will somehow, to some extent, protect the bay. Is that a very expensive thing to do, to collect the storm water from going directly into the bay? That will just be tough.
It costs, so green storm infrastructure, very favorable. It costs $100,000 to $500,000 an acre to retrofit. So you're talking about thousands of acres, tens of thousand acres, lots of dollars. So we're municipalities are implementing it on an opportunistic basis when they're doing redevelopment. But even in the bay margins, however, some of the green stormwater infrastructure doesn't work well because of the high groundwater table and the like. So we're challenged. The challenge with runoff is it's really not possible to capture and treat all that water. But that doesn't mean we're not pursuing it. We're pursuing it opportunistically and where it may be cost effective.
And where there are lots of industries and that may be causing the problem, that's where you're going to be.
The main driver for implementation is redevelopment.
Thank you, Tom. I'm going to take we've got a question on the chat, so I want to make sure we take one of those at least.
A question came in from Lester from SFEI. Although there was, this was for Setenay, although there was no implementation requirements put on the Central Valley, is there effort going on in the industrial areas of Sacramento and other CV industrial zones that may be reducing loads?
I'm really not up to speed on what's going on in those areas.
No, okay. Is there another question from the chat, Lemmy?
Sure. Here's another question from Warren Hatch. Can the PCBs and sediments, like along the shore in East Bay, be moved around the San Francisco Bay via water flow, tides, delta flows, and settle elsewhere? Or are those sediments kind of staying in place? I think it's asking about sediment movement within the bay. Yeah. Can the PCBs and sediments, like along the shore in East Bay, be moved around the San Francisco Bay via water flow and settle elsewhere? Or are those sediments kind of staying in?
Sediment transport question, yeah.
They do move around to differing rates and maybe distances, but they do move around. The SFEI is currently working on a model actually to look at the hydrodynamics in the bay. We will know more, but we do know they do move around, but in different, we're talking about different problems. So for example, Emeryville Crescent, which is an open bay, which is more open to tides, the PCBs and sediment there move differently than San Leandro Bay, which is much more closed. So we have to look at each priority unit and what the hydrodynamics are.
A question up here, or Jim and then Chris.
I'd like to start by thanking Jay for his presentation and the reverse tree, because it gives us a sense of where we can get the most benefit. But there's also a warning that goes with that. I remember Lester and I had a beer a few years ago, and he told me about this sky high level of PCBs coming out of the Gilman drain. And it doesn't show up again. Most of these areas are low-lying, so they're depositional. They'll pick up whatever sediment according to whatever population. So interpreting data becomes difficult because you have to understand the population. But to the point that I think Khalil made, what's we suspected at the Gilman drain was that you had building demolition material being rehandled there right at the bottom of the watershed, and a flood, you know, backing up from the highway. So it seems to me that one of the things we have to do as the numbers for apparent demolition go up is that we really have to stay on top of that. I mean, the good news is we are redeveloping corridors like San Pablo Avenue. The important news is we've got to do a really good job of site control and management at the rehandling sites to make sure that we actually get the loads out of there. You know, are there any thoughts about the regional board kind of looking at construction rehandling and seeing if maybe a little tighter look is necessary?
Well, the most recent version of the MERP, you know, we've based on that as the evolutionary approach we talked about. So the most recent version actually requires all municipalities to keep a tab on buildings that have these high PCB concentrations and, you know, that are going to be up for demolition. And then make sure there are controls in place. And in fact, they let EPA or the water board know we can go inspect the sites. So there are protocols in place to properly demolish those buildings and then properly dispose of the waste. And another thing we learned is that we didn't really require, for example, a manifest that these materials went to the right waste center. So now we're requiring that. And Chris, thank you for talking about the last 3 years of work. So since 2019, municipalities have been actually monitoring and reporting on these buildings that are going to be demolished that have high levels of PCBs. And another thing they need to do is to evaluate the protocol after the after they're being demolished.
So we're trying to get a handle of this and make sure it doesn't go to the surface waters or groundwater.
So I have a question. We're having a lot of discussion now about source control. A lot of your presentation had to do with source control. And source control is a basic tenet of EPA sediment remediation guidance. Like you said, you have to turn off the tap before you can deal with anything that's already there. But we know, as mentioned, that we have a large reservoir of PCBs out in the sediment. Other places, like for example, Portland Harbor, they've done source control work, but now they're focusing on actual remediation of in-place sediments. After we finish all this source control work, which is going to take, what, maybe decades, and we still see a problem in fish, what's the next step? Would it be to go to the sediments and do some targeted work or less targeted work? Or what kind of work would we need to do at that point if we're still not achieving our goals? Well, that's a hard question.
I can take a first stab at that. One of the things that we're starting to work on is this in-bay fate model. And that will help us look at scenarios like that. We can virtually turn off the tap and see what happens. We can virtually take contaminated sediment out of the system and see what happens. So, with that tool, I think we'll be able to make that kind of prediction.
Question up here.
Working now? Okay, good. I'm Mark Silas. I'm from Valley Water. And actually, you just set up my question really well, so thank you for that. But I was just thinking about how, like, in the diagram that was given earlier, the legacy PCBs that are already in the bay have so much of a greater contribution than what's coming in from these really heavily contaminated sites. And so it kind of seems from, like, a mass perspective that getting as much clean sediment into the bay as possible would kind of be what you want, right? Dilute it. But I was wondering, how do you reconcile that with the fact that we take a load-based approach to regulating PCBs? Because places like the Central Valley, where you have a huge sediment load coming in, but relatively low PCB concentrations, are actually probably doing the most good for the bay in terms of PCBs. But yet they're getting dinged on, you went over your load. So something to think about. Maybe it's time for a concentration-based approach.
who was getting dinged on?
for implementation of the team, yeah, right? I guess you're looking at individual.
Well, we're looking at everything, and we're not doing anything about Central Valley inputs, which are modeled. Our models show that it will attenuate naturally in the next 20 years. So we expect that the natural attenuation coming from the Central Valley will take care of that problem. And then we are working on all levels. It's not individual discharges that, the MERP applies to most of the urbanized bay. And then for cleanup sites and building demolition, we may be working with individual discharges. I don't have any comments about concentration based right now.
Question.
Tom has a comment.
Yeah, because we actually are taking a concentration base, and I'll give you some perspective. So, we take the 10 parts per billion in fish level, we base that on a food web model associated to PCBs and sediment. It translates to 1 ppb in sediment bay-wide average. Average levels in the deep water channels or the deep parts of bay are 10 ppb. In the margins, we've done a calculation recently, it's 150 ppb. But sediments coming in from the Central Valley are less than 1 ppb in the water. So the Central Valley, it has low concentrations, high mass, but we're not requiring load reductions because that's already coming in clean. So now we're looking at where are the higher concentrations of PCBs getting into the system. And Jay, one of the challenges you're realizing is even if you clean up a particular site, the nature of PCBs is they created a halo around these sources. And so typical area, old industrial areas often have greater than 200 ppb on average. So you got just runoff from most of the old industrial areas, regardless of whether there's a hot spot, is feeding the bay with dirty sediment that's going to sustain contamination of the bay. So that the challenge is trying to knock down 200 ppb in all those old industrial areas in a cost-effective manner. But that's where we're challenging the municipalities to work with us to find the most contaminated areas, address them, but then the remaining challenge is the legacy from those areas, as we see from GE and these other cases. But that's how we're approaching this. I mean, we're challenging ourselves to make sure we're doing everything that's possible in a timely, cost-effective manner. And as Seth and I pointed out, iteratively, we're getting better at it. So I think we're at a point now where we're going, other than dollars, we have a good idea of what it's available money available. We know what to do. And so that's illustrating the concentration approach is sort of how we do business.
So I think that kind of answers your questions. I think you were getting at, you know, that sediment from Central Valley, if it is low concentration, it actually may be beneficial to the bay if it's covering up higher concentration sediments in the bay. Of course, it, you know, it's got its own transport dynamics. Is it really getting to the areas where we need it to be covered? I think that's what some of the modeling will also help us with. It's in remediation, it's actually a concept called enhanced natural attenuation, where you're enhancing deposition, which is a whole nother topic for San Francisco Bay.
And then how sea level rise and, you know, impacts of how the dynamics will change in the bay and whether those sediments are buried or resuspended based on what happens.
I see the time's up, but I have a quick sort of wrap up comment.
Sure.
Karen talked about the need for more coordination, and this experience that we had with the monitoring RMP did downstream of GE, I think was a really valuable example where we, you know, kind of unexpectedly happened on some really high concentrations. And as soon as EPA heard about them, they, you know, Steve Armin said, you know, we're not going to allow any export from that site, and we want to do something about it. And you saw everything that happened after that, and it's still happening. So I think, you know, more connection of RMP monitoring with these types of cleanups, or more monitoring in general, is needed. I wonder if there's a lot of activity happening that I'm learning more about and becoming more aware of. I wonder if there was monitoring at some of these other locations, if we would see some success stories that have already happened, but, you know, the monitoring wasn't there, so we don't have the information.
Well, thank you to all the speakers and everyone who asked questions. We're going to go ahead and break for lunch and be back at 1:20 sharp. And lunch is upstairs.